Let me go back to the first slide. And in this talk, I would like to give you an update on the new features that are available in AB5 0.9.1. This is not the first time that I give a talk on AB5 at the AbiDev workshop, but still, I believe that it's important to give a very quick introduction to the project just to define the goals. So what is AbiPy? AbiPy is a Python package that is explicitly designed to support AbiNIT. We have tools to generate input files automatically, tools for post-processing data that are usually extracted from NetCDF files. We also use AbiPy to interface AbiNIT with the external tools. And there's also a set of modules that we employ to automate calculation in different contexts, high throughput or standard convergence studies. We rely on PyMagen for the low-level objects, in particular the structure and other scientific libraries. We also use capabilities from AAC and FonoPy, and indeed we have converters that allow us to convert, for example, a PyMagen structure to AAC atoms. How do we install AbiPy? So the recommended approach is based on the Conda package manager. The reason why I like Conda is that it can deal with the packages written in different languages, ranging from C to JavaScript, and it also had great support for Fortran. Indeed, with Conda, you can install AbiPy from the ConDaForge channel as well as the AbiNIT executable. 2 years ago, I presented the AbiConda channel that I created and I was maintaining, but nowadays, all the recipes have been moved to the ConDaForge. And there we have bots that can automatically build and deploy new packages every time that we push a new version of AbiNIT or AbiPy to GitHub. Obviously, you can also install AbiPy using pip. What's new in the latest version at the level of the documentation? First of all, we have a new website based on a new theme that, in my opinion, is much more readable. We added several new examples for post-processing tools based on Matplotlib, Plotly, examples for scripts for running calculations, and each script can be executed on MyBinder inside the Docker container. So this is useful for users who want to try AbiPy without installing software on their machine. We have a new notebook tutorial for Elastic Properties that is inspired to the standard AbiNIT tutorial, but reformulated in terms of AbiPy, and additional examples related to Electron phonon coupling in the official lessons. What's new at the level of the workflow infrastructure? Well, 2 years ago, I already presented the machinery we developed to automate ground state, DFPT in particular phonons, GW, optical properties in the independent particle approximation, as well as with the beta salpeter. And in the last 2 years, we have been working to add additional support for DFPT-related quantities and electron phonon. First of all, we have converters that allow us to go from the DDB file to the FonoPy or TDAP format. And we use these tools to perform calculation with external packages such as i5, requiring the dynamical metrics in the FonoPy format. We also have new flows to compute several quantities, just to mention a few: elastic piezoelectric tensors, an interface with FonoPy, second harmonic generation, Grunheisen parameters, effective masses. And last but not least, we developed a lot of new machinery for electron phonon related quantities. This is not a tutorial on AbiPy, so I don't want to bother you with all the technical details, but I just want to show you some basic examples just to give you an idea on how AbiPy automates stuff. But before presenting the examples, I would like to mention that we have two different infrastructures for implementing workflows. The first one is lightweight, is internally provided by AbiPy. And I say that it's lightweight because it does not require an external database. This is what we use for rapid prototyping and supporting advanced AbiNIT capabilities. If you're interested in high throughput, we provide another package, AbiFlows, that obviously uses AbiPy for the low-level machinery. In the case of AbiFlows, we use Fireworks to implement the workflow infrastructure and the MongoDB database. Now, I just want to give you a very quick example to compute effective masses with the DFPT, and the formalism is detailed in this paper. What are the steps involved in the calculation? We start by performing a ground state run to get the density. From the density, we compute the band structure to find automatically the position of the band edges. And once we know the wave vectors, then we can use DFPT to compute the effective mass tensor in terms of these k-point derivatives. This is the flow that is being used by Joao to generate a database of effective mass tensors for bulk systems. At the level of the Python interface, everything boils down to essentially creating a flow. This is the directory in which all the calculations will be executed. Then we call this function that is defined by the user to build an input file. And once you have this input file, then you can pass this object to this work, effective mass out of the DFPT work provided by IPPI that implements all the workflow logic. So internally, IPPI constructs this dependency graph. So all the tasks are connected to each other, and you can easily run the calculation using the high-level interface. You just execute the script and you pass this argument. And what you get for free is a scheduler who's submitting jobs automatically. Each job has its own number of MPI processes that is optimized for that particular calculation. And the scheduler is also monitoring the calculation. So we have error handlers to fix typical runtime errors. Now, in order to build an input file, there are different approaches. If you are working in the high throughput context, obviously you want to rely to some default settings. And for this reason, we provide factory functions in which you just provide the structure, the list of pseudopotentials. In our case, we take the pseudopotential for the pseudo dojo. So everything is really automated at this level, even the selection of the cutoff energy. On the other hand, if you want to have full control on your input file, you can build it from scratch by just creating the object, and then you start to set the standard init variables using this Python syntax. And then you have helper functions to automate the most, let's say, tedious tasks such as defining the k-mesh. Now, one thing that I usually try to stress when I present IPPI is that all this workflow machinery is not necessarily related or does not necessarily imply high throughput applications. And indeed, we use these scripts also to address technical and fundamental questions. And I personally also use IPPI to debug my new developments in Fortran. So for example, 2 years ago, we started a project whose goal was to test the accuracy of the standard interpolation techniques used to obtain electron phonon matrix elements in the full Brillouin zone. And in order to answer this question, we had to perform hundreds of DFPT plus electron phonon calculation for Q points along a high symmetry Q path. And we had to sample a lot of Q points around gamma to analyze the behavior in the long wavelength regime. Now, I'm not going to discuss all the details of this paper because you can find them in these two articles. The main point that I would like to stress here is that obviously, in order to automate this calculation, we wrote a Python script, and most of the steps and even the post-processing part was, let's say, easily automated thanks to this Python infrastructure. Now, this terminates this first part related to the IPPI flows, but I would like to mention that there are other 4 talks in this workshop in which IPPI is being used. Now, in the second part, I would like to discuss quickly new developments related to post-processing tools. First of all, we added the support for Plotly, and then we are also working on the implementation of graphical interfaces and dashboards that can be used inside the browser. So first of all, why are we moving to Plotly? Well, the default plotting library in IPPI is Matplotlib, and I personally believe that Matplotlib is a great tool, it's rather powerful, and we use it a lot to produce publication quality figures. But on the other hand, there are some drawbacks. So first of all, for end users, people who are not very familiar with Python or Matplotlib, it's relatively difficult to change the figure that we produce because this requires changing the Python implementation. Moreover, Matplotlib or the default figure produced by Matplotlib lacks interactivity and does not play well with HTML. So that's the reason why we are also adding an extra API to plot the most important physical properties with Plotly. Plot3 is a JavaScript library, but we can call it directly from Python. The plots are interactive, and there are also editors that allow you to customize the plot. The main limitation I see is that obviously now you are forced to show the figure inside the browser. This may represent a problem on some high performance centers, but we provide both matplotlib and plotly methods. Now, this is an example of the matplotlib figure for a band structure produced by AbbeyPy, starting from this netcdf file. And as you can see, if you try to embed the result in HTML, what you get is a static PNG file. Now, if you use the plotly API, it's just a matter of replacing plot with plotly, you get this kind of interface in which obviously you can interact with the data. You have a set of buttons here that allow you to select the region. If you click here, then you can also access the numerical values. Well, I don't know why it's not working now, but I guarantee you that it would work. You see? And you can have access to the numerical values. So it's much more interactive than the matplotlib version. Then there's a nice other feature provided by my matplotlib, in the sense that you can upload your figure to the cloud, to the Chart Studio server. It requires you to create an account, but it's free. And on the cloud, you also have an editor. So users can customize the plot, change the title, and change the style. And this solves one of the big limitations of matplotlib. Obviously, plotly supports a three-dimensional plots that are fully interactive. And of course, we have full support for Fanon-related plots. This is the last part of the talk in which I would like to discuss the integration of AbbeyPy with the HTML-based technology, in particular, how to use graphical interfaces inside notebooks, how to create dashboards, and how to take advantage of these new features from the command line interface, thanks to the panel project. Without entering too much into technical details, if you are working inside the Jupyter notebook, you have created, opened a DDB file, and you want to create a graphical interface that allows you to interact with the DDB object and call an DDB. You just call the getPanel method, and what you get is this set of tabs. Each tab has a set of widgets and buttons that allow you to invoke an DDB. Now, in this case, I'm working with a static HTML file, so there's no Python server running in background, and that's the reason why the graphical interface is not working. And for this reason, I have to go to my browser and give you a live demo. So the main idea is that from the command line, you open with the AbbeyOpen script the file, you added the panel object, and if I go back to my browser, I have to exit from the full screen mode. Okay, so this is what you get. I hope that you can see my browser and the plots. So this is the plotly band structure. This is the button that allows you to upload the figure to the cloud. Everything is documented here. Then we have another section with a brewing zone, a table with the isometry key points, the projected density of states, and at the end, you have the AnaDDB input files with links to the official documentation, and everything is automatically created by just clicking this button. Then if we go to this other tab for the bond effective charges, we have epsilon zero in this format. You can download the file in a tech or a file for Excel. And if I go here to this structure tab, you can visualize the structure with the JS mode, and you have access to all the JS mode capabilities, but it's also possible to export the structure to different formats. Let me go back to my talk. This is the last slide. Enter full screen mode. So this is just a summary of the different objects options that are now available in the command line interface. In the previous version, we were used to generate matplotlib figures by adding the exposed version. Now it's possible to generate plotlib figures automatically by just using this object. If you want to show everything in the browser, you use exposed web. And it's also possible to generate automatically JupyterLab notebooks. And inside the Jupyter Lab is really great because you can execute Python code and at the same time, you can create graphical interfaces with widgets to interact with the data. So this, all these options are documented on the Abipi webpage at this URL. And this, with this, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Matteo. So I think there is a time for one, two questions. So I think that there are the questions that are devoted to you, I think also to Christian, which is basically how to convince non-permanent people to contribute because it's not publishable as it is. So how to convince people to extend these capacities, the recipes, and all this scripting?
Well, in our case, fortunately, I'm the main author of Abipi, and fortunately, I also have a permanent position, so I have a lot of spare time to work on this. And sometimes we create some collaboration in the sense that we have a PhD or postdoc who's working on a scientific project as a technical problem. He wants to automate stuff, and I take care of the implementation. Now, as I stressed in the first slides, Abipi is ab init specific. So for us, it's relatively easy to add full support for advanced ab init capabilities. And we work a lot indeed with DSPT and Electron Phonon. We know how the code works internally. So for them, making Python communicate with ab init, obviously, it's not a piece of cake, but it's not extremely difficult.